stirring the pot of intellectual inquiry since October 5th. Welcome, one and all. If I could have your attention just for a moment, we realize that this typically is the dining room cafeteria. Some of you may be wandering in to have your lunch or sandwich, and you're free to do so, although the main meal for the day will be food for thought, which you can digest along with your sandwich. But if you're here primarily to chat, we'd ask that you do that in another room, because we really want to focus attention on the speakers that we have today. The Glacier Room is an alternate location you can go to do that. In any event, my name is Frank Primiani. I teach here in the Business Division, Introduction to Law courses, and Business Law. Some of my students are here. I'd like to have a captive audience wherever I travel. And we're going to present a two-hour program for you today, the first hour of which will be myself and two other illustrious faculty members, Dr. Lloyd Jansen, the Political Science Department, former chair of Social Science Division, and Janie Haney, who is currently the chair or former chair of the English Division, current chair of the English Division. Both very prominent faculty members here on our campus. We have agreed to speak each for about 10 or 15 minutes, and then we're going to follow up with some questions, answers, stimulate some questions among the audience. And then after the first hour is wrapped up, the second hour will be more student activities. There'll be some facilitators in the room. We'll have some questions for you to discuss amongst yourselves, give you some time to collect with other students and consider your own situations and whatever actions you may want to take based on the information you learn here today. So I would like to point out, it is somewhat ironic that we're meeting here in a dining facility, cafeteria. Some of you may wonder as to whether there might be a feeding frenzy going on, and in fact, if we may not be the main course. Something may be eating at you. Something may be eating at your future, your hopes, your dreams, your aspirations. It may be a murky idea. You might not be able to quite put your finger on it, what's causing this feeling. And we hope to maybe enlighten you a little bit, maybe give you some, again, food for thought so you can consider how your situation may tie into what's going on elsewhere in the country and indeed around the world. So without further ado, I would like to introduce, first of all, Dr. Lloyd Jansen, who's going to talk to you a little bit about tuition and taxes, what has been happening in the last couple decades at least, and then we'll have Janie talk about the situation for adjunct faculty and so forth, and I'll talk about privatization in education. So without further ado, I'm going to turn over to Dr. Jansen.
Yeah, there's a handout that goes along with this talk, and it basically provides you with a lot of the data and the citations for what I'm going to talk about. The citations are handout citations, not academic citations, so they're just going to tell you the really basically what the name of the newspaper, the date, that type of thing. Higher education is under attack in Washington and in the United States right now, and I'm going to try to demonstrate that the terms of our social contract, our relationship with each other as citizens in this country, has changed dramatically. I was an undergraduate at one of the California State Universities from 1971 to 1975. I'm pretty old. My tuition on the semester system was $84 a semester, $168 for the year. All right? 18 years ago, Green River tuition was still about $333 per quarter, or $1,000 per year. Currently, Green River tuition and standard fees, and I don't need to tell you this because you're paying it, is $1,323 per quarter, or just a little under $4,000 a year. That, and you probably know that that's up over 14% from last year. The UW tuition, which I know many of you are hoping to transfer to, was up over 20% to $10,575 for tuition and fees this year. In the 2001 year, UW tuition was less than what you now pay at Green River. Tuition increases are not new, but the percentage increases are now dramatic. In 2007, the state subsidized 74% of community college tuition, 61% of four-year college tuition. This data is on the handout, so make sure you get the handout. The state was investing in its citizens. By 2013, it is projected that the state share will drop to 63% for community colleges and only 35% for the four-year colleges. It changes the concept of what a public university is. They are supposed to be alternatives to private universities. Our social contract is changing. Student debt load outpaced credit card debt for the first time this year. More student loan debt than credit card debt. It reached $550 billion, pay attention to this number, $550 billion early this year, up from $440 billion the year before, and by the end of this year, it's projected, it's increasing so quickly, so dramatically, that it's projected to cross the $1 trillion mark. All right? But before this year is over, all forms, now this is interesting too, you might think that people are going into more debt with the recession, but in fact with less income people are really afraid to go into debt. All forms of personal debt have gone down during the recession, mortgage, credit card, home equity, auto, except for one type. Student loan debt has increased, according to the Wall Street Journal, by 25%, and that was a few months ago, so it's gone up more than since then. The debt load in society is shifting to you. The social contract is changing. We have a recession, we have serious budget cuts. K-12 education is mostly safe from budget cuts in Washington State. 93% of the budget is constitutionally protected. It's the biggest part of the state budget, so think about that. Most of that's protected, and I agree it should be. But it's the biggest part of the state budget, so everything else, including higher ed, is going to take very big hits. Tax revenue in Washington is dropping more than was expected since they passed the budget last spring. In addition to cuts already made for this year, we are now being asked to prepare for another cut this year of perhaps 15%. If it were only 10%, the Washington State Board of Community and Technical Colleges estimates that 40,000 students will be turned away from community colleges by 2013. Under our current cuts, we are short-staffed all over campus. We have secretaries migrating between offices, part-time here, part-time there. If you are have an app in for financial aid, you may be painfully aware that as of mid-October, a couple of weeks ago, Green River had not yet reviewed 900 student financial aid applications for this quarter. That's real. Students have been left in limbo. From the end of World War II to 1979, the rise of the middle class, when we saw the rise of the middle class, the top earners paid a top federal marginal rate of 70% or higher in federal income taxes. It was 91% under Republican Ike Eisenhower. That was the very highest. The rates started lowering in the 80s and were dramatically cut in the last decade. The top rate is now 35%, and significantly, it is only 15% for investment income. Thus, the non-working wealthy. The people don't have to go out and work for a living. They just live off their investments, pay less taxes on income tax than middle-class families. For state and local taxes here in Washington State, Washington has the most regressive taxes of all 50 states. What does that mean? It means that those earning less than $20,000 a year pay 17.3% of their income in taxes, sales tax mostly. The top 1% of earners pay only 2.9%. So if you spend something, if you buy something for a buck and you pay sales tax on it, it's a much bigger percentage of your income if you don't make a lot of money, and it's a lot smaller percentage of your income if you're rich. Maybe we like it that way. We voted down an income tax on the wealthy last November. It would have brought in over $2 billion annually by 2013. We have been regularly voting down all sorts of taxes for a few decades now. The American Beverage Association spent a record of $16 million last year to convince us to repeal tiny taxes on candy and soft drinks. I guess that was important to us. The wealth gap. 50% of U.S. workers earned less than $26,364 last year. In 2005, the richest 10% of U.S. households owned 49% of the wealth. By 2009, it had jumped just from 2005, it was 49% of the wealth. By 2009, it had jumped to 56% of the wealth. This wealth is accumulating in the hands of the few quickly. From 1979 to 2005, the top 100th of the top 1% saw their incomes rise by 480%. The poverty gap between the young and the old doubled from 2000 to 2009. According to the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, the richest 10% of Americans earn 16 times more than the 10% at the bottom of the pile. That compares with a multiple of 8 in Britain and 5 in Sweden. In the United States, it was only 7.69 in the U.S. in 1968. I said in the U.S. twice. I guess that was for emphasis. Average income for all workers in a household together is down 9.8% from the start of the recession. Surprise. That's no surprise. We're losing money, right? Guess what? During the same period, the number of those earning $1 million or higher soared by 18%. The gap between the rich and the wealth of us, the rest of us, is getting bigger. And it's getting bigger quickly. 14 million people are out of work in the United States, but corporations are earning record profits right now. The biggest banks are now bigger than before the recession. And all of these numbers are exacerbated if you're not white. For example, whites on average have 20 times, this is mind-boggling, 20 times the wealth of blacks. And 18 times the wealth of Hispanics. Wealth is the things you own, your possessions, your house, your car, your savings. This has been dramatically exacerbated by the recession. Now think about the effects of a wealth gap. In the industrialized countries with the greatest wealth gaps, so if you have a really big wealth gap compared to countries that have a small wealth gap, a smaller difference between the haves and the have-nots. As a rule, if you have a big wealth gap, lives are shorter. We rank somewhere around number 41 now in longevity. We used to be number one. We rank around, you know, Costa Rica is, they live longer than us. South Koreans, they live longer than us. I haven't checked this year, but I know a year, we're right around the same place as Cubans, okay? Heart attacks are more common. Mental illness is greater. Suicide rates are higher. Homicide rates are higher. Crime overall is higher. Imprisonment is higher, more expensive. Teenage birth rates are higher in a society with a greater wealth gap. Economic mobility is lower. Isn't that supposed to be the American dream? We can all aspire to transcend class. Hey, you have a far better chance of doing that in Sweden. levels of distrust between people are higher. Maybe that explains Congress. Self-esteem is lower. Anxiety is higher. Well, yeah, all those other things. That makes a lot of sense. People work longer work weeks. We have the longest work week in the world, in the industrialized world. Governments give a smaller share of foreign aid. Business leaders are less willing to comply with international environmental standards. And this is my favorite, people recycle less. So, I said that's true for the countries with the greatest inequality. Hey, we are number one. We have the most inequality of any industrialized democracy in the world. And by a good measure, we have the most inequality of any industrialized democracy in the world. What does it have to do with access to college? In Europe, where they have more equality, college is free or almost free, depending on the country. And we're going rapidly in the opposite direction. So what do we do? One party in Congress tells us the only solution is to cut more government. Don't fill the holes with more taxes, because taxes are a burden that will stop job creation. Economists and the nonpartisan Congressional Research Service say that is not true, that the evidence actually contradicts this. Economists tell us that we need to spend more dramatically to simultaneously rebuild our crumbling infrastructure and put people to work. More people at work means more spending, which will stimulate more production of goods, and thus yet more jobs. It's really simple. Yet Washington and Olympia, the other Washington and our Olympia, are focused on cutting spending further. This will cut more jobs, lower demand for goods, lower production, and thus lead to a stagnation at best, or even more job losses at worst. And fewer taxes, we just spiral down. Colleges will be decimated. One party in Congress tells us emphatically that Americans want no tax increases on anyone. The other party says otherwise, but then constantly exceeds or cooperates. And check out the Wall Street donations that both parties are getting. Maybe they're right. Maybe they're right. Look at our votes in Washington on the initiatives, the income tax. But a Gallup poll last month found 66% national support for increasing taxes on individuals earning at least $200,000 a year. And 70% supported higher corporate taxes for eliminating some tax deductions. And I heard that support was even much higher if we talked about taxing millionaires, that even a majority of Tea Partiers support taxing millionaires higher. But I couldn't find the confirmation of that, so that's a rumor. Intriguingly, other polling shows that Americans support significant wealth inequality, but mistakenly believe that we already have it. So what do we need to do? We've been snowed, and we need to educate ourselves. That's why you're here, right? We need to educate ourselves. And then we need to take action. We need to organize. We need to make our voices louder. We need a fair tax system, and we need to fight to lessen this huge, dangerous, and unhealthy wealth gap. And let's fight to rebalance the social contract to bring some in, you know, such as racial minorities, who mostly have been left out all along. And it will be even a better society for the wealthy. They will live in a safer, healthier society. It's not just us versus them. They need to learn that this is good for them. Understand that the social contract has changed. Our society is worse for it, and students are taking an unfair share of the burden right now. Will you acquiesce, or will you stand up? A democracy, I teach political science, I teach about democracy. A democracy is not worth much if the citizens are uninformed and quiet. Here's how economist and U.S. Senate candidate Elizabeth Warren, she also was the architect of the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau, is how she put it. GE doesn't pay any taxes, and we are asking college kids to take on even more debt to get an education, and asking seniors to get by on less. These aren't just economic questions, these are moral questions. I'm going to close with one more quote from Elizabeth Warren. There's nobody in this country who got rich on his own. Nobody. You built a factory out there, good for you. But I want to be clear. You moved your goods to market on the roads the rest of us paid for. You hired workers the rest of us paid to educate. That's you. You were safe in your factory because of police forces and fire forces that the rest of us paid for. You didn't have to worry that marauding bands would come and seize everything at your factory and hire someone to protect against this because of the work the rest of us did. Now look, You built a factory and it turned into something terrific or a great idea? God bless. Keep a big hunk of it. But part of the underlying social contract is you take a hunk of that and pay forward to the next kid who comes along. Thank you.
Thank you, Lloyd. And next speaker now will be Janie Haney, who will talk about the impact of this on our institution and particularly on adjunct faculty.
Where are those papers?
Yes, please.
They kind of got off somewhere.
By the way, I know some of you may have questions, and we've decided that if you can hold your questions until all three of us have spoken, that'd be good. But certainly write down your questions so that you can bring them up later.
Okay, here are more handouts. There were 150 printed up, and we may have more than that in the room, so we may have to share.
Hi. So nice. So I see a lot of hands up. I assume they're not for me, but for handouts, so I'm sorry if I'm ignoring you. I told Lloyd I was going to have trouble sitting here because I usually stand and pace and move around a lot when I teach, but he did it, so I'm going to try it too. So I was asked to come and talk a little bit about the adjunct faculty situation at the college since it's one of the topics that came up at the last teach-in, and it's very related to much of what Lloyd alluded to in terms of how all of this situation with the economy affect what's happening at the community colleges. What is the experience that you're having here? And I think students here, the faculty, talk a little bit about this full-time adjunct divide a bit, but they perhaps aren't fully aware of what exactly it is. So I wanted to start first by actually saying, what is an adjunct? How many of you feel confident in what an adjunct faculty member is? What is an adjunct faculty member? Okay, hand here and there. So that's what I want to talk about first. So, the first important thing to understand about adjunct faculty members, they are not allowed to work full-time, right? So, at Green River Community College, roughly, there's a percentage, but roughly it works out to they're allowed to teach 8/9 of a full-time load. That's 8 classes per academic year, as opposed to 9 classes per academic year. They're hired, rather than being given year-to-year contracts, being tenure-track, earning tenure, they're hired on a quarter-to-quarter basis. So they get a new contract every quarter and they can be let go following quarter. So they have little to no job stability. We do have some assurances built into the contract here. Not all community colleges have that. Our college protects our adjunct faculty more than most do. So another key difference between an adjunct faculty member and a full-time faculty member is an adjunct faculty member starts at about $3,000 per class. They're paid per class. They aren't given a salary. So if they can teach at Green River Community College 8 classes in the academic year, that means they can make $24,000 a year.
What?
Yeah, what you said. Which is, I think, as most of you are aware, not really a living wage. And these are people, I want to remind you, with master's degrees, with PhDs, who have earned respect and expertise in their fields. So since $24,000 is really not enough to live on, what do most of our adjunct faculty have to do to make ends meet? They have to get other jobs. So they're teaching here, but they're also teaching often at other colleges. I have actually had adjunct faculty in the English division who are teaching who are also working at Starbucks to make ends meet. Sometimes there aren't other jobs available at other colleges. So, though most of your full-time faculty might be teaching 3 classes a quarter, many of your adjunct faculty are teaching as many as 5 or 6 classes a quarter between 2 different colleges. They might be here in the morning at Pierce College in the afternoon, or Highline in the morning, here in the afternoon, Pierce College in the evening, right? So they're moving back and forth, up and down the highway, spending all kinds of money on gas in order to get here and teach you and to other colleges. What are their working conditions like? While most full-time faculty have offices, and I say most because we do have a whole division living in cubicles, mostly what they have are offices or cubicles that they share. And that includes a shared computer, a shared telephone, all of that. They don't have their own resources to use. Very few of them have places where they can put their belongings, where they are secure, so they carry them with them to and from the bathroom, right? Seriously. So these are the working conditions as well. So that's an adjunct faculty member, right? As opposed to a full-time faculty member. So I think the question we have to ask ourselves is, why are our administrations and our state government, the State Board of Community and Technical Colleges, other boards that govern education in the state, why are they interested in employing adjunct faculty members? Yeah, I'm just gonna talk to you, you're helping me. So money, right? So money is one of the big things, and it's easy to be cynical about that, but there are some legitimate reasons for that. Enrollments at colleges fluctuate, right? Right now, we're in a period of high enrollment. There's some research that suggests that high enrollment period may be peaking, maybe lowering. So one of the things public colleges do is they employ a certain number of adjunct faculty members, cynical as it is, so that they can fire them quickly and easily when they need to. And this helps balance, fire is probably a harsh word, lay them off, let them go, politely ask them not to come back, however you want to put it, right? They don't come back when enrollments drop. And this is how they keep the budget balanced. And there is some good reason for doing that. We're public institutions, we have to balance the budget. There's not a lot, typically, in theory, there's not a lot of money just floating out there to be spent on this and that. So, if that's a good reason, let's examine our own situation. I'll talk about two divisions here at Green River, my own. We have 17 full-time faculty members and 45 adjunct faculty members in the English division. The math division has 12 full-time faculty members and 29 adjunct faculty members. In the English, the situation is particularly dire right now. Our adjunct faculty corps has grown from about 25, about 6 years ago when I started as division chair, to 45 now. So we've really expanded greatly, while the number of full-time faculty in our division is actually lower now than it was when I started. We're not moving in the right direction. So let's talk about that budget flexibility that adjuncts are supposed to give colleges. Let's say our 45 adjunct faculty members, because not all of them are teaching three classes. Most are teaching at least two, a good number of teaching three. So let's say that they equate to about 35 full-time equivalent faculty members. Make sense? Right? That means if they're all teaching three classes this quarter, they account for 105 of the roughly 170 sections that the English division offers. So think about this. How much would enrollment have to drop for the English division to need to cut that many of its total offerings? There would have to be, in my estimation, something like a plague hit Auburn for that to happen. Something of medieval proportions would have to occur for us to have to cut that many sections. So while this is a good rationale, up to an extent, it certainly is not an adequate rationale for keeping this many professionals working at the adjunct level. So the other reason, of course, why might administrations, state governments, etc., be interested in adjunct faculty members, is they have no job stability. They're stretched thin. They have very little resources, not only in terms of the authority and resources that they're given at a particular college, but even personal resources. Their job situations stretch them way too thin. So if you have a core of employees who are stretched that thin and have no job stability, what is the likelihood that they're going to feel that they have a voice at your institution? Particularly if that voice is different than the voice of authority at the institution. Are they going to feel free to fight for the educational environment that facilitates good teaching and learning? Low caps, curricular integrity, creativity and innovation in the classroom, equipment, instructional supplies, all of those things that faculty fight for, and they do fight for it, and they are fighting for it at this college. You have to be able to trust that you cannot be let go at the drop of a hat, to be willing to go into a meeting with an administrator and speak what they don't want to hear. Our adjunct faculty do not have that kind of job stability, make no doubt about it.
And I'm not going to necessarily conclude that that's why our administration or any other administration wants them, but it certainly is a consequence of employing so many adjunct faculty, is you employ a core of faculty who don't have the power to fight for what needs to be fought for to keep your education sound. So, how are you affected by that in the classroom? Any thoughts? I'm looking at you. Yeah? I didn't hear you. Right, teachers are not as available, right? And all of you who know you have adjunct faculty members, they give you an email address. They're not around, right? They can't be. They've got to run off to peers to get to their next class so they can make enough money, right? They're doing their best. So you have teachers who are primarily available to you over email. You have, in a lot of colleges, our college, right now, our college is a fairly unique community college in that we protect a lot of the integrity of our instruction through certain structures written into a United Faculty contract. And a lot of other colleges, things like course caps are set by administration, by deans, things like that. And I've talked to colleagues at these other colleges. So that's another way you can be affected. Your course caps go higher. You become a number of students in a classroom. Your teacher can't give you as much individual attention. When class sizes get too large, the whole pedagogy changes. You can't have seminar discussions if you have 50 people in a class. What you get is lecture, right? Because there are certain kinds of instruction that are simply not efficient or possible with large class sizes. So how you are taught changes. So in a number of ways, employing adjunct faculty who cannot protect those conditions can affect you in the classroom greatly, and is affecting you now. So I want to talk a little bit, I've lost my place in my notes. So one of the reasons why this happens, right, we tend to kind of function a little bit on this idea of student is consumer anymore. The student is the consumer, right? So how does this affect the adjunct faculty situation? Well, one of the things you need to consider, and a lot of times I do hear this from students too, they feel that being treated as a consumer empowers them. Won't the colleges be competing for me then? Right? Doesn't that give me power? Well, why doesn't it give you power? Sure, maybe the colleges are competing for you. But I want you to think a little bit about that relationship between a buyer and a seller, between a consumer and a producer. If you go to a car dealership and say, I have $20,000 to spend on a car, does the car dealership say to themselves, I want to give you the best car I can give you for $20,000? No. The car dealership says, I want to convince you to accept as little as possible for $20,000. Because they want to keep as much profit as they can. So if you are the consumer, if the relationship between an educational administration and its students is a relationship of a consumer and a producer, think about that. What are you asking that, how are you asking that administration to conduct itself? Are you asking it to conduct itself from a place of abundance and altruism, or are you asking it to conduct itself from a place of scarcity and profit and greed? Because an administration that conducts itself from a place of scarcity, profit, and greed will not be interested in giving you the education that you deserve. And relying too much on adjunct faculty is a huge part of that equation. One thing I wanted to share with you, I was doing a little research because I was curious into what are the kinds of things that can be offered at colleges that do have abundance, right? And of course, we're sometimes referred to, I don't know if this is maybe an old thing, that Green River has been referred to at times as the Harvard on the Hill. Anyone else heard this? Is this old news now? No one does it anymore, I know. Yeah. I'm not that old, but I guess I'm getting there. So I thought, well, look at Harvard University, right? And that, well, I'll look a little bit at what their writing program does as compared to ours. If you go to Harvard University and take their equivalent of English 101, you are put in a seminar-style classroom. Every class meets and functions as a seminar. I couldn't find their actual cap. But I assure you, if they're running their classes as seminars, their caps probably are not over 15 a section. They also emphasize the importance of creativity in each class. While they do have course outcomes, they make sure, and they explain, that every teacher will choose their own books and assign different kinds of assignments, because this is a part of preparing students to adapt and be flexible as they go into the rest of the university, to be ready for different kinds of situations. What does this tell you they're preparing their students to be? To me, it says they're preparing their students to be good critical thinkers, and they're preparing their students to be leaders, to be good problem solvers. Additionally, they have a whole thing, a whole program called the Harvard Writing Project, which they have managed to create through a very large grant, and it takes a lot of time to write and get grants. I can tell you this, I've been trying to work on one for the last 2 years. It's frustrating, we're banging our heads against the wall, but we're still hoping to get it. But it takes a lot of energy to put into getting the kind of grant they got. It's called the Harvard Writing Project. One of the things they produced through the Harvard Writing Project is this. A whole set of information, well, it's that they're kind of guides, a whole set of guides that are available in paper and online that are disciplinary specific. So if you're a student at Harvard College, even after you've taken English 101, if you go into Sandy Johansson's philosophy class and get a paper assignment, you can go get the Harvard Writing Project's Guide on Writing in Philosophy, Writing Papers for Philosophy. They have identified certain courses at the college that are writing heavy and written specific writing guides for those courses that are free and available to students. Right? So how is this relevant to this whole adjunct thing? Well, this is what you get when you have a college that invests in a full-time faculty core. People who are invested in the institution, have time to invest in developing programs, have time to invest in students. When you don't have that, you cannot have the other. So what I want all of you to ask yourself is, what does it say to you when your college administration or your state government says they are not willing to invest in full-time faculty for you? What are they saying is the value of your education to them? And what are they saying is the value of you as a citizen and a potential leader in this world?
Thank you, Janie and Lloyd. Well, it seems to me we've gone from big picture to local picture, and maybe even go back to the big picture a little bit to see how what's happening here is really ties into what's happening elsewhere. And Lloyd had alluded to structural problems, perhaps, in the socioeconomic system that we have, and I like a few visuals. Here is one that shows what Lloyd was talking about, the concentration of wealth, U.S. wealth distribution. Sometimes it's depicted as a martini glass with the top fraction of 1% owning about, well, you've heard the statistic, right? I think the top 400 families have as much wealth as the bottom 150 million. So very skewed. Up here they get, of course, the full martini glass. Down here, if you're in the middle of the lower middle class, you may get the sediment, the residue. Down here, if you're down here, you may get a vague sniff of the olive. So if, of course, you turn that around, what you get is the classic pyramid of the how the capitalistic system operates. And actually, this was a image from 1911, where in terms of access to resources, only a few at the top have that access. And most of us here are on the bottom supporting this infrastructure. Of course, to some of us, it may feel more like this, at the bottom of that pyramid, with, you know, holding up the Wall Street gang, right? So, you ever feel like this? You have the burden of the world on your shoulders? Maybe this is why. So we do operate in this capitalistic system, which is not bad. I mean, it's competition. Competition is good. It strives, gives people incentive to make good products, good services, and we want to buy good products and good services. Nothing wrong with that. In fact, the founders of capitalism, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, and others, actually were able to harness the power of the human ego, or in case Karsh is here, probably more precisely, the human id, the unrestrained force that tries to get what it wants. They were able to harness that and channel it into an economic system, which we call capitalism. But a powerful system, as with nuclear energy, needs to be contained. It has aspects to it which are toxic and may even be damaging. So fortunately, we have also socialistic elements in, and I did say socialism, within our economic system. We have islands or structures of aspects to our economic system where we want to give the most access for very essential services, bridges, roads, infrastructure, public schools, which I consider the intellectual infrastructure of the nation, post office, fire department, natural resources. We want to give as much as possible access to as many people as possible there. Well, so while the market, free market is based on, well, the capitalist system is based on markets, the socialistic system is mostly based on principles of how people should live. So if you basically marry those two together, you get something like this. The middle class, right, which has worked pretty well. This combination, this marriage that we've been able to find between unfettered laissez-faire capitalism and socialistic elements within our system, it's led to the greatest middle class ever, supported by a tax structure that was fair, as Lloyd alluded to previously, which has gotten askew in the last number of years. So we don't have the support of taxation to hold this up anymore. The union movement, which has held that up, has been dismantled. Regulations that have contained aspects of capitalism have been dismantled. And I won't say it was all Republicans, because one of the worst things was done was the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act, which was instituted in 1934 to prevent investment houses and commercial banks from kind of mingling. That was done in 1999 under the Clinton administration. But on the other hand, under the Clinton administration, we did have two successive years of budget surplus and an eye toward eliminating the national debt by 2015. Well, you know what happened. We had something called 9/11, two unfunded wars. We had the huge tax cuts that Lloyd alluded to. We had big pharma, the Part D Medicare, which basically was a windfall to the pharmaceutical companies. We had the consequences of the deregulation of Wall Street that led to the financial crisis. We let the contagion inherent in that capitalistic system loose, not able to manage it. So now we've got to find a way to find that middle ground again. This is another depiction of what Lloyd was talking to, the state and local tax appropriations to higher education. This is 1991 and 2004. I'm sure it's much worse by now. But you can see Washington is here, 28% drop. So you can see, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to consider a capitalistic system that has lost its workers. What I'm trying to do is make inverted triangles in here to represent these socialistic islands. If we reorient them along capitalistic lines, let the market decide, let's privatize everything, it's not hard to see what will happen to that middle class. It is going to fall, and it is falling. So, what do we do about it? What are the avenues to rebalance? You are the counterweight. We are the counterweight to the money and the influence that the wealthy have to facilitate laws that are made in their favor and against the common interest. As you've heard Lloyd mention, 66% of the American population favors a tax assessment or repealing the Bush tax cuts and increasing taxes on those that earn more than $300,000 in adjusted gross income. Almost two-thirds favor the Obama jobs bill, which would put people to work building, rebuilding the infrastructure. Yet, nothing is getting done. Why is that? What is the force on the other side that's blocking this? Well, we have to remember what capitalism is. It is not a system that's designed to produce goods for the needs of the many. It's a system designed to generate profits for the owners of the means of production. That's its job. That's what it does. And it does it very well. And in so doing, it concentrates wealth. And the inevitable result of that will be a two-tiered system. We see it in medicine. You may well see it in education. The unrestrained profit motive can be damaging. And if I can turn to a couple of things here on the... I brought some news stories of what happens when you let the private sector take over education and you lose sight of the public interest. The student becomes a customer. Well, we know what customers want, right? We all know that. We're smart enough to tell you. If you're a customer at this institution, you, of course, want the best possible grade for the least possible effort. And we can facilitate that. If that's what it's all about, if it's just pure market, you're the customer, and we'll just give you the grade you want, and then we ask, would you like fries with that? But I hope that you're wise enough to say that's not what it's about. There's another stake in this, and it's the public that are investing, less and less, investing in you, investing in your future so that you can leave and become useful, productive citizens. So in closing, I don't want to take too much more time. I'm just going to go through a couple of headlines as to what happens when you let unrestrained capitalism enter the educational market. You see all kinds of these. I'll just name a couple. Phoenix University recently paid $67.5 million for their compensation program, which is based on incentives. You know how people get paid there? They were actually going to homeless shelters and places and signing up students, getting them signed up for student loans, which we know they default four times more frequently, private schools. The default rate is significantly more than public institutions. Why is that? Could it have anything to do with the profit motive? Perhaps. Likely so. Phoenix University settled that. Of course, they didn't admit anything, but not all is lost, because the president of Phoenix University, the Apollo Group, Inc., he did quite well. He just sold recently stock worth $59 million. So you see what happens. That extraction of financial aid, of that public resource, is being funneled into private hands and ends up concentrating wealth in the hands of the fewer and fewer. How long can we afford to do this? People are on the streets. They feel something is wrong. They're disturbed by it. What can be done? In law, we always talk about time being of the essence. Well, this is one of those times. Time is of the essence. And if we don't do something about it, the wheels of capitalism will run right over us, and we will just be a footnote in history and have to pass the torch to another nation that maybe can learn from our mistakes. I think I'll just close with that, because we're almost close to the 12 o'clock hour. Open up to any questions, and I think each one of us would love to elaborate.
All right, folks, we have some time for questions, but we also want to allow you all to have discussions at your own tables. So I just want to make a couple of comments about that. That we've held two teach-ins this quarter. The last teach-in was at the Glacier Room, and that was at capacity, so we're at a much larger venue now. I see a number of people leaving. Before you leave, if you have to leave now, do please sign your if you're interested in remaining in touch. We want to turn this teach-in over to you as the students, right? We can sit up here and throw facts, numbers, keep talking, but ultimately you have to be the ones that mobilize. You have to be the ones that decide that this is your education. So please sign up on a sign-up sheet. We have a number of sign-up sheets around, and also fill out a response form. On next Wednesday, a week from today, we're going to have a meeting, 1 to 3 o'clock, for you all to come in, tell us what you want, how you'd like to participate, how you'd like to take leadership. So that's why it's really important that you sign a sign-up sheet before you go if you want to remain involved, okay? But there's room we have time for some questions and comments. So please come up to the stage so that you can address everybody. And then we'll, for those of us who want to stay and continue discussing, we'll discuss in the individual tables as well. Thank you. If you need to go, but you want to continue following, this is actually being tweeted live right now. You can continue following even after you leave. At GRCC Teaching on Twitter. Thanks.
Thanks, Nick. As you're generating your questions and so forth, there may be some microphones out there somewhere. Any microphones out there? Or do we have? I'll circulate this one. Anybody have any questions? Or you can just write them down.
So during this time, you guys brought up a lot of interesting points about some of the problems that are in the current economy and the community college situation. But what specifically would you advocate for how to address this issue?
Thank you.
I would say for myself that the answer is what the answer has always been. It's the answer that the ancient Greeks knew when they talked about the golden mean. It's the answer that the Buddhists know when they talk about yin and yang. It's the answer that our forefathers had when they separated powers. It is fundamentally a question of balance. Balancing the moneyed interest versus society's interest. And we've lost that balance point, and that's what has to be restored, in my opinion.
I agree with Frank, absolutely, that we need to rebalance the system. But think about this. This is going to require a great change. How has great change come about in the United States? Slaves received their freedom through a civil war. I certainly hope we don't come to that. But how did women attain the vote? Through a social movement. How did we get worker safety laws? How did we regulate and virtually abolish child labor in the United States? Through a social movement, the progressive movement. How did we get out of Vietnam? Through a social movement. How did we achieve civil rights laws that were fair? Through a social movement. We probably need a social movement. We need to organize at Green River Community College. They need to organize at the University of Washington. They need to organize at Bakersfield Community College in California and the University of California and the University of Nebraska and the University of Massachusetts, etc., etc. And if you organize here and you organize there, it will come together as a social movement. But it's a big project. I don't expect change overnight, but we are way out of balance. Way out of balance. We were out of balance before the Great Depression, and interestingly, we came largely back into balance during and after the Depression. The wealth gap was quite small, and it was during the Depression, believe it or not, that the middle class began to grow. The wealth gap was lessened. The wealth gap, The wealth gap, the middle class began to grow, and the wealth gap was small. And it's during that period, through the 50s, I mean, think about, how well the middle class did during the 50s. Well, especially if you were white. Again, as I mentioned, not everybody was included in that. But it's out of whack now. And I think that it's going to take organization. So what you guys need to do as students is you need to organize. You need to educate yourselves. You need to identify what the problems are, and then you need to make noise. Social movements make noise. Women who wanted the vote were willing to go out and get themselves arrested and thrown in jail. People who wanted civil rights legislation were willing to sit at counters, even though it was illegal, and get arrested and go to jail. And I'm not saying you have to go to jail, but you do, but I am saying you have to make noise. That's how democracy works. You have to be noticed. The squeaky wheel does get the grease.
I'd like to point out, even though it took a long time to correct some of the social injustices, like separate but equal, those things, took 60, 70 years. But things can happen fast, too, if there's enough momentum.
Well, one thing that I have to remember as being an African-American student, I have to remember what my forefathers before me fought for. And I have to look at myself. Is it my turn to fight for my future and my children's future and the future of everybody else? Yes, it is that time. So just like they stood up and did all those social movements, we got to do it too, as one, like they did. Sometimes you go back home, you need to ask your parents what they really fought for. Because I know some of y'all parents are paying for you to come to school, making sure you're well taken care of. They're fighting for you, just like you're fighting for a better future. So you got to look within yourselves and look at these older adults who want us to have this and looking and saying, hey, something, man, big is about to happen that's either going to make us great or tear us down. Thank you.
Questions? I know you've got some questions out there. You can't be that hungry.
More comments.
Hungry. Yes, come on up. By the way, as we're talking, I'm putting some of these stories up, these news articles about some abuses in the private sector that you might be interested in following up.
So my question is, how did the banks acquire wealth? Was it from selling loans from foreclosures and then receiving bailouts, or is there other ways that they acquired their wealth because they are making so much money as people are losing money?
Well, the banks have been really good at getting money on both ends of the deal during the housing crisis. They would sell essentially bad loans, what they call liar loans or ninja loans, no income loans that they knew would never be paid back. But they were able to just to get the regulations such that they would, their liability was limited when they passed these bad mortgages on. And then, of course, when they sold them on the other end, they profited as well. They knew what was, that it was bad and that many of these loans would not be repaid. And they actually took positions, investment positions, counter to what they were selling. In business law, we'd call this fraud. Right? You see anybody going to jail? Although Rajaratnam, I noticed, got 13 years for insider trading. I'm not sure that was directly related to the housing scandal. But compare that treatment with what they could have done instead of bailing out the banks. They could have bailed out the homeowners. There actually was a bill in Congress that would, what they call cram down. For people that were in bankruptcy, they would cram down the mortgage amount, because a lot of people were underwater. They'd cram it down to the fair market value so that people wouldn't lose their homes. Congress did not pass that. They bailed out the banks instead. Does that address your question? How they make their money? Well, they thought they did. They were too big to fail, right? Too big to fail. Repeat the question. Did they really need the bailout? Well, of course, they were too big to fail. What's that? That's right, we had to bail them out. See, what they really like is capitalism for us, socialism for them. That creates a very perverse incentive, because if you know you're going to be bailed out, you're going to take unlimited risk, aren't you? Because Uncle Sam's going to bail you out because you're too big. How did they get too big to fail? I mean, some members of Congress have said, well, if they're too big to fail, maybe they're too big to exist. What happened to our monopoly laws? Been in place since 1865, the Sherman Antitrust Act. Very seldom enforced. Why is that? Could it have something to do with the pervasive influence of money on politics? Perhaps so. Come on up.
All right, so Bank of America stopped giving student loans and they started, they sold all the student loans to the federal government. All right, Bank of America stopped doing student loans during the recession, and they sold all of their student loans to the federal government. And how is that affecting the ability of student loans?
Excuse me, sir?
As far as private student loans, it wasn't for private companies to do it, so you get all of that.
Okay, I'm not an expert on student loans, but and I'm not sure.
He teaches business law.
But I'm not sure I completely answered or understand your question. But right now, in fact, they're rewriting the rules for student loans and how to get them and so forth. There's been a big Senate hearing, commissions on this. But what's happening is very interesting, because as I the default rates on those student loans much higher for poor profit education. And so Senator Harkin has been having hearings and looking into this, right? So as you would expect, lobbyists for these corporations are trying to influence how the rules are going to look and who's going to qualify and who's not going to. Right now they're looking at you have prospects for gainful employment. And they're also looking at how do you define what default is. Well, the private schools want to define default very narrowly so that it only encompasses maybe a two-year period. But we know that most people that default after that 2 years. So it makes them look better than they actually are. So they're playing with the numbers. But I'm not sure I answered the question. Carmen.
Okay, I just wanted to update. Before I came to campus today, I was watching Obama speak
on this idea of what he's going to do with the student loans. And it's a continuation of a bill that was passed a year ago, I believe, that was being implemented in another 2 years. Well, this begins next year. What Obama was saying is that you're going to be able to consolidate your private and government loans into one government loan at a reduced interest rate. Second, rather than have the cap at 15% of your income determining how much you pay each month, it's going to be reduced to 10% of your income. That will be the cap. You will never be asked to pay more than 10% of your income on your student loan. Second, rather than the 30-year cap, there's a type of loan forgiveness that he's talking about now, that after 20 years and you haven't paid off your student loans, well, then you don't own any more student loans. And there will be a debt forgiveness and that thing. So these were the three ideas that Obama apparently is going to write with an executive order, and he says it will start next year.
Oh.
So, folks, that wraps up our formal presentation part. And those of you who are able to stay, we want to discuss at the individual tables. We want to know, we want to be able to develop our ideas, have conversations, make sure that we're getting our questions answered by our peers, we can develop them, and decide what we want to do. And so if you're able to stay, then we ask you to consolidate these tables so that we can have conversations with about 8 people at a table. If you are a facilitator, please raise your hand and take a table, and then if you want to stay, come to one of these tables where you see a facilitator, okay? We have 4 questions that you all can discuss. You can talk about whatever you want, and then we're going to write up on that butcher paper what you came up with at your table, okay? Facilitators, please keep your hands raised. And you.
College keeps going up. I'm barely struggling to keep everything paid. I work full-time. I work. I go to school. I pull loans. My parents try to help when they can. It's still not working. If college keeps going up, my family definitely can't afford to, and I'm just going to keep burying myself in more debt. The more people I talk to, I see that's pretty common, you know, across the board. How do you guys feel about that?
I would say we're already renting it. We should be paying for it through our taxes. I think our tax money should go towards education and not other stuff, yeah. But, well, my father started out, like my whole income is based off my father. My father was low middle class, and now he's below the poverty level. And I am lucky because my grandma is high middle class but she supports me, my mother, and other people. So it's like having, you know, like a bunch of lower people. So, yeah, it's just, I think everybody should pay taxes. Paying taxes is being American, it's being part of your country, it's contributing.
You mentioned he's pointed like some of Karshap. You guys know him as a professor here. He says that the most important thing in a society should be educating the youth or whatever, and we talk about as a society like, oh, education's really important. Well, if we're not putting our money towards it, it's not really important. We have all this money going, all these different places, but we keep cutting from education. So it's kind of like, put your money where your mouth is. If education's so important, why are we cutting it? So I agree. I think we pay a lot of taxes. The government has more than enough revenue to cover us to go to college. Those that want to. I agree. I think the taxes should pay for a majority of it, if not all of it.
and unfortunately, to add on to that, a lot of taxes that they've been wanting to cut. For instance, we need tax, we have our sin taxes, and a lot of that goes to education. And yet they don't mention that part of it. They're always like, oh, it's bad, they're taxing for no apparent reason, and it's going to whomever. But it really, they're attacking our money for education.
I was a girl from Norway in one of my classes, and everything's free for education there. She came over here, they're paying for her pocket expenses, they're paying for her plane tickets, her housing, and her tuition, and her books, and everything.
No. Or more sometimes, but they're very wealthy here. Norway, Sweden, Denmark. To me, that's the model of a population of people willing to pay a lot of taxes to ensure or to follow the social contract that Lloyd was talking about, and that is paternity leave for fathers, healthcare, making sure that everyone's safe, making sure that everyone has an education.
If everyone has an education, does it flood the market, whereas anyone can go to college, that means anyone can get a job? Is it tougher to get a job with a college education if everyone's, you know, it's free for them to go? You know, does it not value the education as much?
It would be interesting to see unemployment statistics. I don't know them. But I guess the way that I think about it is more on an idealistic level. So yes, there's more competition for jobs, but at the same time, you're ensuring that everyone in the country has an education. And I think that's a fundamental human right, the right to have an education. So it makes your country more safe. It makes, obviously, people more informed. They vote in an informed way, just like the way you express your voice. My guess about employment or would be connected to birth rate. So how many kids sometimes I think the birth rate might be lower as a means for population. Not sure, but I think
I was going to say, too, as poverty levels go up, birth rates seem to go up, too, which is probably not necessarily the best thing, but, you know, we start having more kids when we're in crisis.
That's job competition. More people. Yeah.
I agree. Like she was saying with the Swedish people, we have the Danes that just came to a couple of our classes and everything's paid for over there. I always think that would be a much smaller economy over there. If a small country can just hand out money to pay for their traveling expenses to see the world and pay for their college, I don't see why we can't in a society with more educated people. It seems like a win-win. So
it's actually, that's a way to mitigate unemployment. I know in Iceland, the Icelandic government will be able to go live in another country because they know that at times there aren't enough jobs. So that's a way for them to say, hey, there aren't jobs in our country, but we'll fund you to go, but then you have to come back. That's part of the contract too. Like they don't want to force all their educated population to go, but they're saying, go have an experience, get a job, come back, make our country better. And that's seems like a good reason. Never fly in that country, but we can work for it.
Okay, so for number one, we're kind of all in agreement that our taxes should pay at least like a majority or most of our college. Obviously, the only way to do that would be through, you know, budget cuts or something like that. So we can write that down. We'll have to come back. We'll go to number two, and then if we have extra time, we can come back and try and brainstorm some more ideas. Do you think the inequality that exists among faculty affects the quality of education you guys receive? I think definitely. I think majority of my teachers that I've had for my first year here have all been like adjunct faculty. The availability, not even like I was looking at the syllabus earlier this quarter to try to find my teacher's office. His office was listed as the classroom, so I show up at the classroom during his office hours. There's another class happening. I'm like, okay. So you email, they're pretty good about like responding to your emails, whatever, but that's just not enough. Like, that's part of the reason I was attracted to community college. It's a smaller class size, the more, you know, interaction you have. thought we had, you know, things strain on us. So I see, I see our education definitely getting better. Is that even a problem you guys were aware of?
It's
at all these loans from, you know, students that have already, you know, started their degree that are working towards it, seems like it's, you know, taking resources away from us. So I'm not sure if that's kind of fair to say, like, oh, we're more important than you, but it seems like you're targeting, you know, it's, I don't know, it seems kind of overwhelming.
Well, I think, when the focus of an educational institution is much different than the focus of an educational institution. So, in a sense, I think a lot of students
that the motion gets, so it's like you can actually get a point out of it.